In this segment, we'll continue our examination of Article 16 and the standards of practice that interpret Article 16. Standard of Practice 16-6 tells us that when we're contacted by the client of another realtor who is considering possibly entering into an exclusive relationship with us for the same type of service they're already receiving from another realtor, we can discuss the terms on which we might enter into a future agreement with that potential client. Or we can even enter into an agreement that becomes effective upon expiration of the existing exclusive agreement, provided we did not directly or indirectly initiate the contact or discussions. Put another way, while we cannot directly or indirectly solicit another realtor's client to offer to provide them with the same services they're already under contract to receive, if that client, without any inducement or encouragement on our part, approaches us to discuss the possibility of creating a similar relationship, we can discuss that possibility, or even enter into an agreement that will become effective after the current agreement ends. Some realtors mistakenly believe that because they've had business dealings with a client in the past, that makes the former client theirs on an ongoing basis. That conclusion is not correct. Standard of Practice 16-7 tells us that just because we've acted as a client's exclusive agent or broker in past transactions does not prevent other realtors from seeking that former client's future business. Similarly, Standard of Practice 16-8 tells us there's no grace period following the expiration of an exclusive agreement, and other realtors are free to enter into agreements with our former clients after our current agreement expires. So, what can we do to avoid unintentional or inadvertent violations of Article 16? Standard of Practice 16-9 provides some practical guidance by requiring realtors to make reasonable efforts before they enter into a representation agreement to determine whether a prospective client is already subject to a current, valid, exclusive agreement for the type of real estate service that we want to provide. Article 16 also establishes some key disclosure requirements. When we act as a buyer broker, we must disclose our relationship to the listing broker at first contact, and we must provide written confirmation of that disclosure to the listing broker not later than execution of a purchase agreement. The same holds true when we act as a tenant representative. In that case, we disclose our relationship with the potential tenant to the landlord's representative at first contact, and follow up with written confirmation not later than execution of a lease agreement. When we are a buyer representative dealing with the seller and the seller's property is not listed, we must tell the seller about our relationship with the buyer at first contact, and we give the seller written confirmation of that disclosure not later than the execution of a purchase agreement. Similarly, when we represent a tenant and we are dealing with an unrepresented landlord, we disclose our relationship with a tenant to the landlord at first contact and follow up with written confirmation of that disclosure. If we represent a buyer and anticipate that we'll ask to be compensated by an unrepresented seller, our request for compensation from the seller must come at first contact with the seller. When we act as a listing broker, we disclose our relationship with the seller to buyers as soon as practicable, and follow that disclosure with written confirmation not later than execution of a purchase agreement. Similarly, if we are acting as the representative of a landlord, we disclose that relationship to potential tenants as soon as practicable, and again, follow up with written confirmation. In any case where a property is exclusively listed, or where a buyer or tenant is exclusively represented, our dealings should be carried on with the client's representative or broker. We do not deal directly with an exclusively represented client, except under certain narrowly defined circumstances. We are permitted to deal directly with another broker's exclusively represented client where those dealings are initiated by the client, not by us. And before we provide any substantive services, which can include writing a purchase agreement or developing a CMA, we ask whether the customer is party to an exclusive representation agreement. If we learn they're exclusively represented, we do not provide substantive services, except where that customer's exclusive representative consents or where we're directed to provide substantive services by the customer. The standards of practice dealing with Article 16 also address other issues. In cooperative transactions, where we have offered compensation for cooperative services, we pay that compensation to a principal broker in the cooperating firm, not directly to sales licensees or non-principal brokers employed by or affiliated with another realtor. The only exception is where the realtor principal in another firm knows and consents to direct payments to a